Good morning, friends. It's a pleasure to be a part of this online course, and I'm happy to handle this particular session on statistical tools for data analysis, theory and practice. And dear friends, we have been taking part and we have been conducting a lot of research works in our academic environments, whether it is a journal article or a book chapter or a conference paper, or you are undertaking some kind of minor or major projects, or you are guiding your PhD scholars or MPhil scholars. We are all one way or other way we are involved in the research process. The research begins when you identify your research problem. You conduct a very comprehensive review of literature. You analyze and find out the research gap existing in your field of research, the chosen field of your interest. You decide objectives based on your research questions. You design your research methodological aspects. You decide upon the data collection instrument. You collect the data, maybe with the help of interviews or questionnaires or schedules or focus interviews or group discussions or online survey tools, whatever it may be. Now data is there with us. See, we have got data with us. What are we going to do with this data? See, long back when I was doing my PG or MPhil or even PhD, we used to have all the data which we manually entered in tables in big papers. We used to call it as a master table, where all the questions, all the answers will be entered. From the master table, we used to get a lot of small subdivided tables. Then we use our calculators, normal calculators, scientific calculators, and with a lot of analysis. Fine. So once you have data with us, we have to undertake a very important process that is required in your research work, that is data analysis. In fact, the interpretation of what you find, that follows next. But before you do that, you have to analyze your data, you have to manage your data. Okay. And this data analysis can be done either manually or using any softwares. Basically, what do you mean by data analysis? See, first of all, before we think about analyzing your data, you should have the data with us first. So either you have to enter the data one by one, or if you have got data already available somewhere, you'll be importing your data. So you should have data first. Then based on the data, you have to prepare frequency tables. How many males, how many females, how many like this, how many like that. So that kind of simple frequency tables, followed by crash types, 2 into 2, 2 into 3, 2 into 4, 3 into 2, such kind of crash tabulations, multi-level tables. So you should be able to generate tables based on the data, what you have collected, what you have entered, what you have imported. Then based on the data, you should be able to generate charts. The chart can be a pie chart or a bar chart or a clustered bar chart or a histogram or a line chart or whatever it may be. You should be able to generate charts. And then very importantly, you have to apply the suitable statistical tools on the data what you have. So depending on many parameters, you decide what is a suitable tool for my particular research data, then you apply the data. And once these statistical tools are applied, you get some output, some response, and these responses are to be inferred. You should analyze and you should write the interpretation. So all these things take place in the process of your research work called data analysis. Fine. And in this session, I would like to give a very fundamental, basic concepts related to statistical analysis, because these fundamental information will be useful to you when we take up a practical session on use of statistical softwares. Fine. So the first thing you need to understand is the types of variables. See, variable is nothing but something which varies from respondent to respondent. It's nothing but the questions. See, if you're having 40 questions in your research questionnaire, then there are 40 variables. And these questions and these variables can be either qualitative or quantitative. So quantitative variables are measured in numbers, maybe the amount of money you spend in a particular day, number of hours you spend using internet in a day, the amount you saved in a particular month, your quantitative data. Whatever qualitative or attribute variables, there's something like your eye color, your personal traits, religious affiliation, your gender, your nativity, these are all qualitative variables. Fine. And these variables can be either independent or dependent. Please make a very, very clear understanding of these two concepts. Because in many of the statistical tools, they talk about these two variables, independent variable, dependent variable. Fine. The independent variable is also called as experiment value or predicted variable. See, it is a variable that is manipulated by the researcher to get valid inferences. In fact, all the socio-demographic variables are treated as independent variables. Your gender, your age, your qualification, your nativity, residing sector. So all these things are independent variables. See, if you take your qualification, I can manipulate the qualification. So I can divide the population, I can divide the sample into those who are with the UG qualification, PG qualification, MPhil and PhD qualification. So based on this particular variable, I can divide the people. I can make divisions in my sample. These variables are called independent variables. Then comes the dependent variables, we call they are outcome variables. So what is the outcome? Maybe the mark scored by a student is a dependent variable. So what can be independent variable? Maybe his gender, maybe whether he goes for tuition or not, whether he undertakes online classes or not, whether he is good in communication or not, number of study hours he spends in a particular week. These are all can be independent variables. So dependent variable is the outcome variable. Independent variable is a predictive variable. Fine. And these variables have got four levels. Please understand there are four levels of measurement. One is a nominal data, the data which is not having any kind of ranking or ordering. We are simply nominating. For example, we just allot. So for example, gender, we say one is male, two is female. We just allot. We are nominating one to be male, two maybe female. You can allot any number for the matter. You can have 100 for male, 120 for female. It's up to you to decide. So there are categories, nominal data, your gender, your nativity, your education qualification, your residing sector, they're all nominal data. Then comes ordinal data, when you have a kind of ordering, when you've got a kind of order between the items. See, for example, you give three or four cool drinks to respondents, you ask them to rank them. These are first one, second rank, third rank, fourth rank. So that kind of ranked data is called as ordinal data. Then comes interval and the ratio. So both are commonly called as scale data. Both are numbers, numeric data. Fine. But you can ask the question, sir, what is the difference between interval level and the ratio level then? It's very simple. As far as the ratio level is concerned, there is a inherent zero starting point. There is an original zero. If you say that a person is not working anywhere, his income is zero. If a child is not at all written anything on the examination paper, his mark is zero. So when there is a true zero point, that is a ratio data. When this true zero is not there, when there is a natural zero point, that is interval scale. For example, you take a Celsius degree. For example, there is a place in Himachal Pradesh who has got minus 5 degree or 0 degree Celsius. 0 degree Celsius doesn't mean that there is no temperature out there. Fine. So, but statistically we take both interval level and the ratio level as same. Both are treated as scale level data. Fine. Then comes summary of the characteristics for levels of measurement. I just give a summary. See, nominal data, it's only can be classified. Okay, make of the car. Ordinal data, something like rank in the class. It can be ranked. Interval data, meaningful difference between values are there, but there is no true 0 point. For example, there's nothing called zero size. When you go to a shop and ask, there's nothing like zero size. Ratio, meaningful 0 point will be there. Fine. So these are the summary of these four levels of data. And another question comes is, sir, why should we bother about these levels of data? It's very simple. These levels of data, understanding of these levels of data will help you to decide what kind of statistical tools you can apply on this step in this data. So knowing the level of measurement of data will help you to finalize what statistical tool you can apply on this particular data. So you should have a clear understanding of this nominal data, ordinal data, and scale data, which consists of both interval and ratio data. Then statistics basically about two different branches. One is descriptive and another is inferential. See, descriptive statistics is nothing but a description of what you have collected. Just describes. It just gives you the state of affairs. It just tells what it is. That's it. Then comes inferential statistics, the most widely used by the researchers for testing their hypothesis. Okay. That is inferential statistics. So let's see about these two. So as I told you, descriptive statistics, it summarizes, it simplifies, and it helps you to present your data. It describes your data. How many males are there? How many females are there? Total number of respondents for this study. Totally how many said yes to this question? How many said no to this question? You can have a chart, something like that. So these are all placed under descriptive analysis. So in descriptive statistics, you can have three different types of analysis. One is frequency distribution. You simply say that 40% are female, 20% are UG qualification, 30% are assistant professors, that kind of frequency distributions. And secondly, you have graphical representation. You use all kinds of graphs and charts. And thirdly, we have summary statistics. So you need not tell, for example, if you have collected data from 100 respondents, you need not tell what first respondent told, what second respondent told. No need. You can summarize and give a single data, single answer for the, a kind of representation for the entire sample. So this frequency distribution, graphical representation, and summary statistics. These three are called as descriptive statistics. And when you talk about summary statistics, you can have two ways of summarizing your data. One is measures of central tendency, which talks about averages. And there's something called the measures of variability, and where we talk about an average variation. Fine. And measures of central tendency has got three different items: mode, median, and mean. If you're having a numeric data, you can go for mean, which is the arithmetic average, median, the middle value, mode, the most occurred value. If you're having qualitative data, only mode is possible and mean is never appropriate. Okay. If you ask a question, how many of you like Vijayakant or Rajinikant, something like that? So we can find out how many say yes, how many say no, which is mode. That is the mode. Only qualitative data permits you to use only mode, never mean. Fine. Then comes the measures of variability, where we talk about the variation. To what extent a particular variable is away from its mean. See, you can either have a range. You take the highest value, lowest value, you find the difference, that is the range. You find out the variance. Variance means to what extent your observed value is different from the mean value. You can find out the variance. You go for standard deviation. You just find out the square root of variance and you get standard deviation. And you get the standard error of the mean. That is, this is nothing but the standard deviation of the sampling distribution. Fine. So you can use all these measures to to show the variability of your data. I'll just show here, if your data is nominal, you can use mode for central tendency, and you can use the frequency or percentage distribution to show the variability. If your data is ordinal, then you can use median as a central tendency measure, and you can use a percentage distribution as a measure of variability. If you're having either interval data or ratio data to scale data, you can use mean as a measure of central tendency, and you can use a standard deviation as a measure of variability. Fine. Then what about this inferential statistics? As I told you, descriptive statistics tells exactly what it is. But inferential statistics is something different. See, there's a big population. From the population, you take only a small sample of students or respondents for your research work. There are n number of samples which you are not taking. That means, out of the total population, we take only a very small number of respondent sample and we analyze and we do research. In inferential statistics, after collecting data only from very few samples, we are going to judge how the population would be. So just like what your mother does, no? So when your mother is very busy in cooking, no? When she wants to test whether rice is cooked or not, she may not take the entire rice and pinch it in everyone to find out whether it is cooked or not. What she does? She just takes either one or two rice. She checks whether it is cooked or not. If it is cooked, she comes to an understanding that the entire bowl of rice is cooked and she switches off the latch. That is what we call as inferential statistics. So what are we doing here? We are generalizing from samples to population. We find out something from a small sample and we'll apply these findings to the entire population. And secondly, inferential statistics are used when you want to test your hypothesis. And thirdly, whenever you want to find out the relationship existing between the variables and among the variables, whether it is a kind of an association, it is a kind of a difference, it's a kind of a correlation, when you want to check this kind of relationship among the variables, or when you want to make a kind of predictions based on the data what you have, you can always have kind of predictions using statistical tools. So all these things comes under inferential statistics. Fine. Okay, that's what I told you. Now, I was talking to you about the hypothesis and testing hypothesis. See, hypothesis is nothing but a tentative statement, an assumption, what you have before you start your research work. So based on your observations, based on what you read in various reviews of literature, or based on your discussion with your friends, colleagues, and research supervisors, and based on what your grandma says, your friend says, based on your experience, you have one hypothesis, you one assumption. Okay, with that assumption, you conduct the test. Once the test is conducted, you can decide the assumption, what you had, whether it is true or not, whether it is accepted or not. For example, before you start listening to this particular class, you have assumption, whether the class is good, the class is going to be good, it is not bad, it is going to be very bad, boring, some kind of assumption you would have had in the beginning of the class. At the end of the class, when I enter the session, you will check whether the assumption with which I enter this class is okay, I am accepting it, and I am rejecting it. Right? So that is what the hypothesis. See, normally hypothesis is stated in the null form, something like there is no significant difference between male and female in number of hours they spend on WhatsApp. There's no much difference between rural students and urban students with regard to the type of breakfast they take in the morning. So hypotheses are normally stated in null form, and we want to decide whether I am going to accept this hypothesis or I am going to reject this null hypothesis. How? After doing a kind of statistical analysis. At what level I am going to accept or reject? Normally, internationally, there is a standard called 0.05. That is, up to 5% I can manage. 5% errors by chance can be accepted. If the percentage of error goes beyond the 5%, the occurrences are more than 5%, then I will not accept. So that is 5% is the internationally accepted standard for accepting or rejecting your null hypothesis. Fine, good. So what are the four steps you need to follow in testing your hypothesis? First of all, you should state your hypothesis. You should write your hypothesis. What is the hypothesis? There is no significant difference between gender and the preference of soft drinks. Fine. It's a very simple hypothesis. You have to write the statement. Then you fix what is your level of probability, level of significance. As I told you, either you can have 5%, or you can have 1%, or you can have 10%. But universally, in social sciences, we go for 5% level of significance. So 0.05 is taken as the cutoff point. And what I thought, step, you do a statistical analysis either manually or using some softwares. You find out something what you call as p-value, probability value, or sig value, whatever you call it. Whether you call it as a p-value or you call it as a sig value, it doesn't matter. So by doing an analysis, you get the sig value or p-value. Fine, third step is over. And what is the fourth step? Whatever sig value, whatever p-value you have calculated, that is to be compared with the level of significance what we had already fixed. You fix it either as 5% or 1%, 0.05 or 0.0 you have fixed. Now you have to compare these two. Which two? The sig value or two value what you got out of your statistical analysis and the level of significance what you have fixed before. You compare these two. And you decide whether you are accepting null hypothesis or you are rejecting null hypothesis. See, if the p-value what you have got out of your statistical analysis, if that p-value is less than 0.05, then the null hypothesis is rejected and the alternative hypothesis is accepted. Suppose the p-value what you got as a result is more than the significant level of 0.05, then the null hypothesis is accepted. Fine, it's very simple. These are four steps, which are applicable for all kinds of statistical tests. Then come there is something called one-tailed or two-tailed tests. What are they? It depends on whether your hypothesis is directional or non-directional. See, if you're having a directional hypothesis, you have to go for one-tailed t-test. If you're having a non-directional hypothesis, you go for two-tailed tests. See, when you're conducting a test, you very, very clearly, you are knowing that I'm going to study two variables, that is income and demand. So I know very well that whenever income is more, demand is more. Whenever income is less, demand is less, is universally accepted truth. So I know very well the relation between these two items. So if you want to test this hypothesis, then naturally you have to go for one Taylor t-test. You know very well that it will be like this. Whenever income is increasing more and your demand is also more. But there are cases, many cases where you will not be having any idea whether this can be this way or that way. You're not sure. It can be either this side or that side. See, for example, I want to check to what extent male students and female students differ in their attitude towards Facebook. Okay, so I'm not sure. I have to conduct a test, either it can be positive, it can be negative. Either it can be more time spending or less time spending. They may rank it higher, they may rank it lower. They may rate it best, they may rate it the worst. So I don't know how they're going to give their opinions. So when I'm not sure about my direction of results, I should go for two-tailed test. I think it's fine, clear. Then very importantly, we have two groups of statistical tools, parametric test and non-parametric test. And you should exactly understand and clearly understand on what occasions I should conduct parametric tests and on what occasions I should conduct non-parametric. Fine. See, to decide whether you have to conduct parametric or not, there are certain assumptions. There are certain conditions. If these conditions are fulfilled, then you can conduct parametric tests. If the conditions are not fulfilled, you go for non-parametric. What are the conditions? So I will tell you two conditions. One is the data what you have collected should be either interval data or ratio data. That means there should be a number data. There should be a scale data. If that is a number data, numeric data, interval data, scale data, ratio data, then you can go for parametric test. No problem. One first condition. Okay. You have collected the data in numeric form. What second condition? The data should be normally distributed. The data is normally distributed, then you can go for parametric. So two conditions. The data should be a numeric data, and the data should be normally distributed, then you can go for parametric tests. If any one of these two conditions are not fulfilled, then you can go for non-parametric. That means the data what you have is either nominal data or ordinal data. So you have to conduct only non-parametric tests. Otherwise, you have collected the data which is a numerical form. Though it is a numerical form, though it is a number data, if it is not normally distributed, then again you should go for non-parametric tests. So be very clear with these two tests. I was telling you something about test of normality. You should decide whether your data is normal or not. What is normal data? So normal data is a data which has got very less number of upper extremes, very less number of lower extremes, and a majority of responses will be of medium in nature. Okay. For example, if you ask somebody, how is a recent movie, Ponmagal Vandhal? Yeah, there is a movie like that in Tamil. Yeah, very few students, very few participants, very few viewers will say that, oh, that is a fantastic movie. Yeah, very few viewers and respondents may say that, oh, such a hopeless movie is that. But a majority of the viewers pass the comment that, oh, it's okay, you can watch it once. So that kind of data is a normal data, a normally distributed data. How to check whether the data is normally distributed or not is very simple. You can go for this case test or go for SW test, and you can decide whether your data is normally distributed or not. Otherwise, no, you can simply draw a histogram for your research data. If you get a kind of a bell-shaped curve, no? So when you draw a histogram, if your data is in the form of a bell shape, you can come to a conclusion that the data is normally distributed. What is a bell shape? Less number of lower items, less number of higher items, medium items will be more numbers. Otherwise, there is something called kurtosis and skewness. If the value of kurtosis or skewness range between -1 and +1, if it is between -1 and +1, then you can say that the data is normally distributed. So there's a few ways. Fine. Let us come and discuss about parametric tests. As I told you, when you want to conduct parametric tests, the data should be numbers and it should be normally distributed. These are the conditions. What are the various parametric tests? It's a t-test. If you want to conduct a t-test, what are the conditions? The data should be numbers. And the independent variable what you are going to use for this particular test should have only two levels. What do I mean by that? If you take gender, this independent variable is having only two levels, male, female. Fine. If I take another independent variable called nativity, it's got two levels, urban, rural. So your independent variable should have two levels, and your dependent variable should be in numbers, then you can conduct t-test. There are two different kinds of t-tests. You take only one simple set of students, respondents, you compare with them their mean value, and that is independent groups t-test. If you're having two groups, you can go for paired sample t-tests, or a single group with the two different conditions. For example, before attending this class, after attending this class, your knowledge about statistics. See, you get two different data, pre, post, before, after. So you take set of people, two set of people, one group is getting treatment, other group is not getting treatment. So you just get their data from them. You can go for paired sample t-test. Fine. And independent variables, as I told you, if it has got only two levels, you can go for t-test. If there's more than two levels, 3, 4, 5, 6, you can go for ANOVA. ANOVA stands for analysis of variance. Your independent variable should have more than two levels. For example, education qualification, UG, PG, MPhil, PG, PhD, four levels are there. You take designation, assistant professor, associate professor, professor, three levels are there. So when your independent variable is having more than two levels, and the dependent variable is in numbers, You can go for ANOVA. So ANOVA may be one way ANOVA or two way ANOVA, three way ANOVA or something like that. Then comes Pearson correlation. So when you're having two data, both the data are numbers. When you want to find out the relation, a linear relation that exists between these two variables, you can go for Pearson's correlation coefficient. And this will help you to find out the existence of linear relationship. What is that? When one variable increases, other variable also increases. When number of hours, your study time increases, the number of marks also increases. When your income gets less and lesser, your savings gets lesser and lesser. So this kind of linear relationship can be studied through correlation studies. Fine. So we have seen three different parametric tests. What about the non-parametric tests? As I told you, when your data is in ordinal form or nominal form, you can conduct non-parametric tests. Or when your data is in numbers, but it is not normally distributed, then also you have to conduct only non-parametric tests. Okay, fine. What are they? One is I-square, the most widely used statistical test for hypothesis. When your data is in nominal or ordinal data, you can go for hypothesis, I-square. When you want to test whether there is an association between one and another group of people, you can go for I-square. For example, there is no association between male students and female students and the choice of groups in 12th standard or in 11th standard. So this is a very, very basic question. If you want to check the association between these two variables, you can go for I square. Because the boys, girls, two groups, they are nominal data. Whether they want a science group or commerce group or humanities group, once again, it is a nominal data. So when you want to compare two nominal data or two ordinal data, or one nominal, one ordinal, can go for high square. Then comes Mann-Whitney tests. It's nothing but t-tests. Okay, both t-test and Mann-Whitney are one and the same. T-test is a parametric test. Mann-Whitney is a non-parametric test. Okay, here also, your independent variable should have two levels. And the data can be either ordinal or it can be numbers. If it is an ordinal, you have to conduct only Mann-Whitney. See, if the data is in numerical form, it is in numbers, but data is not normally distributed, you have to conduct Mann-Whitney. It is equivalent to t-test. Then comes Wilcoxon signed rank test. It is equivalent of paired sample t-test. So you got the pre and post, before and after, such kind of data if you're having. So before introducing a particular technology in your shop, how many products are sold, how many products are sold after the introduction of particular technology. So before, after. You can go for this particular test when you're having ranks or when your numeric data is not normally distributed, you can go for Wilcoxon signed rank test. It is equivalent of paired sample t-test. Then comes Kruskal-Wallis Hutch test. It is equivalent of one-way ANOVA. When your independent variable is having three or more than three levels, when your dependent variable is ordinal data or your dependent variable is a not normally distributed numeric data. If it is, so you can go for Kruskal-Wallis. It is equivalent of one-way ANOVA. And this is Spearman's rank correlation. When you want to compare two ranks, not numbers, you got two ranks. Yeah, student is assessed by two different teachers. They have ranked the students. So if you want to compare the relationship existing between these two ranks, you can go for Spearman's rank correlation. It is equivalent to Pearson correlation. Pearson correlation is used when numbers are there, numeric data is available. Spearman's rank correlation is used when the data is available in the ordinal scale. Fine. And to do these kinds of data analysis, we got a lot of softwares. The most commonly used one is SPSS. But in fact, SPSS is very costly and everybody cannot afford. We cannot afford to get SPSS. See what to do. So, a statistical software is a software that helps you to do all the data analysis work. What have we discussed? A statistical software should help you to enter the data, to edit the data, to import the data, to generate the references, to generate the tables, different kinds of tables, to generate the charts, to conduct the statistical test for testing hypothesis. A statistical software should be able to provide you all these things. Okay. Since ASP.NET is very costly, we go for the freely available, free and open source statistical softwares. Many such softwares are there. They are free. You can just download and use it. For example, you can see on the screen, JASP, OpenAP, DAP, many are there. PSPP, SOFA, XLispStat, many such kind of free softwares are available. In the second part of this presentation, we may talk about the practical aspects of SOFA statistics. See, SOFA stands for Statistics Open for All. It is an open source package and it is written in Python language and it has got a GUI. It has got a graphical user interface. It's very easy for you to go on to select the things and you can give the commands. And you can integrate this with all kinds of databases like MSQL or PostgreSQL or SQLite or MS Access and such kind of things. And SOFA is available for many kinds of operating systems, whether you have MS Windows or Ubuntu or Linux or Mac, you can use SOFA. And if you're good in Python, even you can write your own scripts for conducting different kinds of statistical tools. And this is the homepage of SOFA Statistics 1.4.6, the latest version. You can see it has got two sides, left side and right, so two panels are there. And left side, we have provisions for entering or editing data, provision to import the data, provision to report tables, provision to create charts, and provision to conduct a statistical test. The right side, we have a panel for getting online help, to set up preferences, to take a backup of our data and to come out of software. Fine. And the SOFA software is very, very simple to use. So very, those who are in PG or MPhil projects, you can definitely can make use of this particular software. It's more than sufficient for you and it provides all the basic statistical options, whatever you need for conducting your research work. So try to use such kind of softwares and see that you use it and you reap the fruit and you share this information, the goodness of these kinds of open source softwares with everybody, with all the friends of your circle. So thank you so much for listening to me and maybe we will meet you in the second session wherein we would have a practical demo of this particular SOFA statistics. Till then, thank you so much.